Today we're going to start the first reproducibility session or BordeauxTea session for 2022. And as you might know, it became a PhD course, so it will be part course, but also everyone is welcome to join, even if they're not following this as a PhD course. And today we will give a brief introduction about the reproducibility initiative, then explain a bit about the practical side of the PhD course and what you have to do. And then Fjola is going to present a bit on the open science and the paper that we chose for today. So the reproducibility itself was an initiative that started in Oxford with these three PhD students. Back then they were PhD students, now they are postdocs. And they just wanted to discuss how to improve their practices in research. And so they started by just meeting and discussing some papers, which became a podcast and now became this huge umbrella, which is a reproducibility. And now they are present in several countries, you know, all over the world. But here in France, last year when we brought the BordeauxTea, it was only two other universities. And now we are five in total, so it's cool. Growing. So as you know, if someone is new, the idea is to give you an introduction of how we work. We work with monthly sessions. So we usually every last Tuesday of the month, depending if there's a holiday or not. But from what I saw, there's none this year. It's usually article focused. We make some exceptions, but we ask the presenters to present an article in which is presented like 20 minutes max. And then the rest of the session is for discussion. So as long as the restrictions allow, we try to do it in person and Zoom. As you see, hybrid is not easy, but we are trying to keep both because we know that we have people that like to come here, but also people that prefer joining online. We also have, we are present in different platforms. So we are on Twitter. We have our Open Science Framework webpage where we put our schedule. We have the newsletter, which you can subscribe to get the news each month. And we also have an email if you want to contact us. And this is the schedule for this year. So basically these are the dates and we update every month. Basically we add the information for the next session. And ideally with the PhD course, each of the PhDs will present in one of these dates. So we will try to sort that out today as well. But if you can follow our schedule here. And now as a training course, we plan to have 10 sessions this year, which gives 10 hours of training if you're registered in the local system in the ADUM. And to get the certificate to validate the hours and also to get a certificate for presentation, you have to attend 90% of the sessions. You have to host or mediate one of the sessions at least. And you have to create and revise one of a FORRT summary, which Fjola will explain in detail a bit in a few slides. So we always meet at this room, Salle Sud, at the Carrex campus in front of the Broca building, and at 5:30 p.m. And as I said, the sessions remain open to whoever's non-PhD students, sorry. And ideally we record every presentation, if we have the consent of the presenter, of course, to put them on YouTube. But if it's okay if you don't want that and you want to present in any way, it's no problem. We just don't post it online. And the sessions, as I said, we'll try to remain hybrid. So this is our proposed program. And basically today we are introducing the course and the concept of open science. And then we have some propositions of general topics that students could try to use, look for papers and present on their sessions. But this is very flexible, so don't stay attached to this. If there is any other paper that you would like to present and it doesn't really fall under the specific topics, just let us know and we can accommodate for sure. So just to give you an idea. And we have some suggestions of papers in our Open Science OSF webpage. So if you go to our OSF webpage, to the bottom part, you will see some Zotero list with some papers that you could choose from in case you have no ideas. And this list is based on the website Foster Open Science. So it's a cool website if you want to have a look. Now, Fjola is going to explain the FORRT summaries.
Okay. So as Eduarda explained, one of the main things that we've added to the course now and for which we're very proud of is the FORRT initiative and the FORRT summaries. So basically, FORRT is the framework for open and reproducible research. And as you can see, what it does is just aims to provide pedagogical ways of conducting open science, and so that science is reachable to everyone and is able to be taught to everyone. And fortunately, they have different ways of achieving this. And one of them is through FORRT summaries, with which we can be helpful as well. So since every month we're going to be discussing a paper, and since one of us is going to delve really deep on it, so the presenter, why not also write a short summary? And the summaries that they have usually include the title, the main takeaways, a quote from the article, which is relevant and interesting and sounds, I don't know, fun or kind of summarizes open science in a sentence or two, or the main message of the paper, the abstract, which is you'll just copy paste, and then you will have the epistyle references, and you can also suggest other papers which would sound relevant to people who will be reading this paper. So as you see there is one paper, this paper, Paul Zucks in crisis, science risk losing the next generation, and then you have all the main takeaways. It doesn't have to be so much in our case. Some papers have like only like four main takeaways, so you don't need to use 20 or as much as they have. In this case, maybe this paper was very prolific, I don't know. So, and then you just place the APA reference, the abstract. Here it doesn't have a quote, but it would be nice to have one, and just other research that you think the reader who's seeing this finds relevant. The purpose of this is mostly so that people, you sometimes just want to know the main summary of the paper. You don't want to, you don't have time maybe. So, and sometimes the abstract is not enough. Usually researchers just read the abstract, but for students, for us, it may be more useful to have also some takeaways. And this is a way of also helping open science to develop. Okay, so now the paper that we are going to talk about today. So the basic idea is that I'm going to shortly summarize what the paper says. And basically, this is the paper that talks about the challenges of open science and benefits. So it has three main challenges in open science, three main benefits, and the tips that the author suggests of how we can solve this by using these methods. And mostly it's focused on the early career researchers. So that's kind of us and people who are postdocs in a way. So what's going on now? Like the main problem that we're facing and the main reason why there's such need for us to be making this reproducibility, this journal club, or to be discussing even of open science, or for even open science to come into focus, is the fact that there's a crisis in reproducibility. And of course, there are a lot of people, like you can see the percentages, there are a lot of people who are saying that no, there's not a crisis, but there are very few compared to the one that acknowledged the crisis. And of course, this crisis was first noticed in psychology, but now we see it in a lot of other fields, and it's really concerning. In one of our sessions, we also talked about re-science and trying to reproduce their own code and tenure reproducibility challenge. And we know that very, very few people manage to actually do this and to get it done. And so here is kind of like a survey of what's going on, not only in coding, but also in other fields. And you can see that it's mostly a fail, so they cannot reproduce their research. So if a research cannot be reproduced, how credible is it really? And then the ideas of what may be contributing to reproducible research. And of course, some scientists may say it's just bad luck, but we know that's not it. There are many more important reasons that actually need to be, we need to focus on and think of. Okay, so basically this is also a recap that the author makes of why it's we are such at such a bad state and why this is considered a crisis. And then the recommended solution or the suggested solution is just shifting to open science methods. And some of these methods are, I don't know, like for instance, sharing code, data, research materials and methods. Some others are registered reports, which in which we're going to focus quite a lot today, and pre-registration, exploratory reports, like even understanding the difference between exploratory reports and registered confirmatory reports is a very important key point in open science. And then pursuing replications and reanalysis. This is also something we discussed last year for the ones of you who were present. And then the methodology, trying to both express how what methodology we use, but also making it possible so that other people can do it. And that can be done by documentation, to which, unfortunately, a lot of people don't pay attention to, but recently it's becoming more and more necessary to think about. Okay. So there are three main challenges that I mentioned at the beginning. One, so if we want to do open science and if we all want to make reproducible research, what are the main challenges that are being faced by researchers who actually try to do this? And the first one is restrictions on flexibility, because you already have a registered report where you claim that you're going to do this, 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 and you don't have key, but we're going to delve into that a bit later. The second one is the time cost. And the third one is that the incentive structure is not in place yet. And I guess we all know that this is a real problem, because most people don't know what's going on and what does really open science and reproducible research mean. So on the restrictions on flexibility, so the idea is that when you have a registered report, you present a hypothesis, but the hypothesis has to be set before the data is actually collected. So everything that you design on the experimental and the analysis setup has to be pre-planned before the data is collected. And at the moment that you are collecting the data, if you notice something that's interesting or something that you want to delve into deeper, or if another research came out, another paper came out, and you want to explore the same idea that they have been exploring, you cannot really change your methodology and you cannot really change the analysis that you're using, because you already registered everything and you're supposed to follow exactly. So this is something that doesn't allow you exactly to have the chance to be as flexible as you would normally be, but you could always do exploratory analysis. So if you're doing a confirmatory research, you have to obey to the rules that you yourself placed in the beginning. So these are the analysis that I'm going to do. This is the hypothesis that I have. But if on the way you find something interesting, of course you can do some exploratory analysis. You just have to say that it's an exploratory analysis. And of course you have to replicate it later with a confirmatory research. So that is one thing that they have about, one constraint that they have. And some tips that are given for that is to use pilot data. So if you use pilot data, so if you're doing a pilot study, you will know what you will encounter on the way. So you will already have an idea of what analysis you will have to think of, or what analysis need to be added. So when you're actually collecting the data, you won't really be surprised and be in need, in most cases, of new analysis. Okay, so the distinction between planned and exploratory analysis. So planned, we say you have a clear hypothesis, and exploratory is something that you come on the way. And then these are, of course, more valued than the exploratory research, because the exploratory ones have to be replicated. And you have to be honest about mistakes and not judge others on the mistakes that they've made. The greatest challenge, actually, is the time cost. Because everything that you need to do, you need to pre-plan before everything happens, before you actually collect the data. And if you're doing it, so you all know that if you want to publish a paper fast, you do the experimental paradigm really quickly, you start collecting data, you start doing everything that you need, you start writing the paper, and it may take quite a shorter time. Whereas if you're doing registered report or pre-registration, most of the time, you for instance, need to do a pilot study. You need to write a registered report. You need to write the methodology. You need to investigate much in detail the analysis that you need to use. You kind of need to pre-plan every possible thing that could happen, or most possible things that could happen, so that you have an idea of how to handle them. So in this sense, it is kind of a challenge, but it is suggested that people recognize that these people are actually doing open research and the rewards that they get, but also the training that these researchers get to be more valued compared to research who are doing closed science, let's say. So yeah, even the funding, there are specific funding for these type of researchers because they're actually taking so much time. So a lot of things are changing, but the incentive structure isn't exactly in place yet. So not a lot of people know what exactly is going on. So not a lot of people are aware that they need to pay attention to this because this is actually open science and actually value this kind of research differently than they would value another research. So you need to carefully plan everything, and you always need to look at open science practices that are in place to be aware that you're doing exactly what is necessary and to be kind of updated because it's changing so quickly, most things. So you need to be as updated as possible. And you need to be aware that although most people, or at least 50% of people in your specific field, won't understand what you're doing or why you're doing it, they will understand in a bit more time than you need it, maybe, but it will get there. So some of the benefits now. So these were three challenges, which are quite hard to overcome, but there are some ideas of how to handle them. And also there is some hope in the future that things will evolve in a fast way to help us actually overcome them more easily. Now the benefits. The first one is greater faith in research. We know that everything that is actually published makes sense. It has been thoroughly thought of, and no one is actually trying to fraud us because they cannot. They cannot deceive us because everything has already been there. And also, you can publish anything. Okay, well, I'll delve into that later. There are new helpful systems, and in the end, there's investment in your future. So for greater faith in research, the first thing is that everything is already available, so you cannot really deceive the system. You cannot say, oh, actually, I wanted to say this hypothesis. I mean, you cannot look at your data and make the hypothesis based on your data. So that creates some faith on the research that you're doing. The second one, which is quite interesting, is null findings. So if you do a study and you have a hypothesis, and that the hypothesis that you have is not confirmed, or you're not getting the result that you can most times, or if it's not beautiful or sexy enough, most times it's not able to be published. But if it's actually an open science research, and if it's pre-registered, or if it's a registered report, and if the methodology is so intact and is so good, it has already been accepted as a registered report. So when you get the result, it has a guaranteed publication. And this study here has taken into account, I think, 153 hypotheses. And then they see that how many of them actually managed, how many of them were null findings. And you can see that the registered reports, all published, or most of them published, also null findings. So that's also a help for researchers who are scared that they may not be able to publish their work. Okay, so there are also frameworks when you can always check how you should do the pre-registration or how registered reports should be done. So they're open, and we can share the links with you later as well, and we can also put them on the site. It may need some more time to do the registered report and the pre-registration, but it's worth it. Another benefit that it has added, and which we're all benefiting from, whether we're doing open science research or not, is this helpful tools, which are open access, and we can all use and see. So first of all, it's GitHub, or this is also another Bitbucker, I think it was. So GitHub and Bitbucker are kind of similar, and GitHub, the idea is that everyone can publish their code and you can easily access their code and you can see what's going on and run it for yourself. So these are tools which make it more reproducible. Then you have Jupyter notebooks, you have R markdowns, you have brain imaging data structures, which kind of provide some pipelines to use. Then there are open data that you can access online and run your own analysis. You have analysis pipelines that you can do. So there are so many tools that are currently available, which you can use to both find data, analyze data, to train on how to analyze data, and also to run code or see how different codes works to replicate different studies. So in that sense, the best thing to do is to take advantage of this and to benefit from them. And the third one is investment in your future. So most probably open science techniques, the way everything is going, are going to be the future of science. Also because we see that, for example, with COVID, we saw that the fact that it was open science and the fact that the research was reachable, someone somewhere did something and someone in another country did something. And because this research was communicated, it was possible to make a vaccine so quickly or to find a solution to a problem that actually affects us all. So that's the reason why it seems like open science is the future. So you want to... So you would want to see how different collaborations inside the open science framework are going to work. And it's always nice to try to make your research in open science, because there are a lot of positions at the moment and there are a lot of institutes which are only focused on doing open science. So that's definitely going to be a step up in anyone's career if they try to focus on it. And one area which is also quite interesting is if you want to pass to industry. So if you're a researcher and you want to pass to industry as a software developer, they also had a very similar applicability crisis a while back. So they're quite happy to welcome people who do open science just because of this, because they are more prone to develop systems and algorithms or pipelines which are replicable. So yeah, so even if in your lab or if your PI or someone doesn't know about open science and you really want to do something about it, just have the discussion and see how they feel about it, and just be the first one to open the way if you think it's a good idea, if we have convinced you.
Yes. And now just to sort of summarize some of the what is under this umbrella, the open science term, just to give a closure that is more like a general closure. We wanted to have an idea that this term really encompasses a lot of things. So it's from open data to open access publication, to open methods, to open peer review, open source software, for example, and open resources, which also touch, for example, education. So there's a big side on open science and education, which we don't discuss as much as researchers, but it's also very important. And FORRT is really part of that. So the idea that we try to make education as accessible as possible to people that wouldn't have it otherwise. So I think that's a really nice thing for like countries that are usually poor, for example. And we are basically making the knowledge more accessible to everyone. So I think it's cool. And so the benefits, we hope they are clear, but if they are not, we'll be discussing them across this year and in every session. Of course, we know that this movement is not perfect, but the idea is that we educate ourselves and try to make these benefits as possible as we can. So for example, here for researcher, as Fiola already mentioned, you can get greater visibility, more collaborations, you can improve the efficiency in your lab, you can get more funding. So this is really the reality in Europe, for example, but in the US as well. So we now have several grants coming from the European Commission, but also country-wise, that are focusing on open science practices, so open data or open methods. And more, it's a mandatory thing that researchers have to do. Some countries in Europe are also changing how they evaluate and hire people. So for example, in the Netherlands, they are now asking people if they have some sort of trace and proofs that they contributed to open science or science in the open way at any point in their careers, and this is really counting for the hiring process. So it's important to be informed. And for the funders, they can better know how their money was used and try to invest in projects that are more accessible and reproducible and have a greater chance of becoming something else possibly. For the general public, we know that it's important to share knowledge. We know that it's also a touchy subject because it can be sort of scary to put the information out there, but it's important also that whoever is funding the science also has access to what they are funding, because in the end, a lot of the research funds come from taxes, and this is an important thing to come back to the society. NGOs and organizations, same idea, so they can have enhanced access to research and try to formulate policies that are better informed. And the same idea for national governments. So this really touches different parts of society. Early career researchers or young researchers, is, of course, we cannot change everything with this one monthly sessions, but I think the most important part of this course is to stay informed and understand what you can get and implement in your own research and just try to do better research if possible. So we would like to thank you all for being here and already showing interest in open science. And now we will open the floor for discussions and any comments.